Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to Collider Mailbag. My name is John Campy. I'm going to be your host this weekend, and thank you for joining us. Now, some of you might be noticing that this is not the way Mailbag has been looking usually. We're going to try something for a couple of weeks. As you remember, last weekend, because everybody was on vacation, I did Mailbag myself from Canada, and we got a lot of feedback from you guys saying that some of you kind of really like the more intimate feel of just a one-person mailbag, and you like the fact that we got through about 60 questions instead of the normal 6 to 12 questions. And so we thought just for the next couple of weeks, we're just going to try a more casual, laid-back, informal mailbag for a couple of weeks just to see if you guys like it. And if not, we'll switch back to the other thing. Whatever. Give us your feedback. That's the most important thing, is give us your feedback, because we want to try to respond to what you guys like as much as we can. So the way I do this when I do it alone is a little bit different, because, you know, it takes a lot of time for me to go through emails and pick out questions. So what I had you guys do is I put up a post on my Facebook page, and you can follow me on Facebook or on Twitter at John Campia. And I put up a post saying, hey guys, leave your questions for mailbag here. And that way, when you guys leave the question, we had like almost 400 questions left, and they're all like just right here in front of me, really nice and easy for me to read them. I'll figure out a better way to do it later, but that's where we're drawing these questions from, and we've got an awful lot of them. I'm going to try to get through as many as I can, so thanks for being with me, and here we go. The first question today comes from Kenneth Britton, who writes, do you think Gareth Edwards will direct another Star Wars spinoff, perhaps taking over Boba Fett? That's an interesting question. I have a feeling that the directors for the spinoff movies will probably just do one-off spinoff movies and then move on to other things. Now, I haven't heard Lucasfilm or Disney say that. I haven't heard anybody confirm that. It's just my suspicion right now. I suspect that when they get somebody in to do one of the spinoffs, one of the anthology films, if you will, that they'll just do one anthology film and then move on. It is possible, however, that, you know, I think Gareth Edwards did a great job with Rogue One. Maybe he comes back. But, you know, would he come back for something like a Boba Fett? Let's keep in mind, number one, nobody has said there's going to be a Boba Fett movie for sure. That's not on the books yet, even though we all kind of suspect Boba Fett's going to be the next anthology film that they announce. But number two, there's a lot of people speculating that if they do a Boba Fett movie, people like Christian Harloff are speculating that maybe Clone Wars and Rebels executive producer Dave Filoni might be given the tap on the shoulder to go in and direct it. So could we see Gareth Edwards back to direct another Star Wars movie? Even though he did a really good job with Rogue One, I doubt it. But it is absolutely possible. Let's keep our eyes open. All right. The next question comes from Ali Admorald. And by the way, guys, forgive me if I butcher names. You know I'm terrible with names. I'll do my best. And he writes, do you plan to direct a movie again? So I've directed a couple of movies. Like, I did a documentary called Prince of Peace, God of War, and I wrote and directed a comedy called The Anniversary, both of which I'm very proud of for what I did them for. And I enjoyed directing very much. However, I think I think I really like producing more. I'm finding more and more I really enjoy producing, including our new Awesome Tacular show and whatever. I don't know. I'll have to wait and see what happens. Riley Johnson writes, who is your favorite superhero on TV or film? My favorite superhero, although you can debate whether or not he is a hero, is Magneto. I've always thought Magneto is like one of the most interesting dudes ever put to film. Especially when you look at him in the comic books, he is one of the most misunderstood, inner conflicted hero/villains that you've ever come across. I love Magneto for a million reasons and more, but you should get into him. If you don't know a lot about Magneto, other than Ian McKellen playing him in the X-Men, and he did a great job in the X-Men, or Michael Fassbender playing him in the X-Men, and Michael Fassbender did a great job, I really suggest reading some of the great Magneto titles. And read Magneto in Age of Apocalypse as well. That's where you get a real sense of the duality in him. Look, at the heart of it, Magneto, and this is where the first X-Men movie did a really good job. Magneto is a dude who represents one of the most terrifying things about villains, the villains who think they are doing the right thing. I've always thought that villains who think they're doing the right thing are far more terrifying than the traditional monsters. I'm out for global domination. I want to destroy all humanity. Like, Magneto, in his heart of hearts, he thinks what he's doing is right, and that's what makes him really scary. But that's what also makes him very interesting. Especially in the comics, he comes across a lot of moral dilemmas that he has to face and moral choices and things that he, according to his standard of morality, it's really complex. There's multiple layers to the dude. That's why for me, Magneto's the guy. Okay, Oscar Herrera writes, when will John Boyega be on Jedi Council? Now, John Boyega, of course, plays Finn in the Star Wars universe, starting in The Force Awakens. We did an interview with him. Christian Harloff sat down and did an interview with him. And John Boyega, for those of you who haven't seen the video clip, John Boyega, before the interview gets started, goes, no, wait, I just want to say, I'm a big fan of Movie Talk. I'm a big fan of Jedi Council. Now, this is, you know, he's been watching ever since our AMC days. So he goes, everything on AMC. So this is going back like a year ago, right? And he, so Christian said, well, we got to have you on Jedi Council sometime. And Boyega said, absolutely, I would love to do Jedi Council sometime. Now, we continue to reach out. We want to have him on. We would love to have him on. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk to him down at Star Wars Celebration in Orlando. But as of right now, there are no plans. Not because we haven't reached out and because we haven't asked. We have been asking, but understand, the dude is now a major, major star. So his schedule and where he's going to be, he's all over the world shooting stuff. So it's tough to pin down a time. So as of right now, I do not know for sure when John Boyega is going to be on. We just know John Boyega has said he loves the show and he wants to be on. But when we can, I'm sure that's not going to be the last time that happens today. When we can actually make that happen, I'm just not sure yet. Okay, let's move on to the next question. That comes from Zachariah R. Couch, who writes, will you be doing a March Madness movie tournament? Ah, for some of you, we didn't do one last year, I don't think. Which sucked that we didn't do one last year. But we, for the previous couple of years we did, we like to do, for those of you who don't know, in March, I like to set up this March Madness tournament to coincide with March Madness in the NCAA. And, you know, what we do is, and we involve you guys vote on it. And we set up a bracket of 16 or 32 and with individual matches. And then we have you guys vote on the matches and the winners move on to the next round, next round, next round, next round. So we did, I think we did best comic book heroes of comic book movies of all time that I think one we did best action films. I can't remember what our second one was. No, best animated films of all time was the next one we did. That one was a lot of fun. I don't know what the topic of this year's March Madness is going to be, but damn right, we're going to do a March Madness this year. I've been looking forward to that ever since, you know, they skipped one last year. So I'm super excited about it. All right. Brandon Pasek writes, do you think Marvel gave DC a roadmap of how to do a Robin character in the Iron Man Spider-Man story in Civil War? No. No. The stories are completely dissimilar. Not to mention, you know, I've said for a long time, this is interesting. I've said for a long time, look, I don't think Robin works in live action. I can sit down and talk Robin with you in the history of Robin and all the different Robins in the comic series and in the animated series all day. And I think he's worked great, not all the time, but no character in comics works great all the time. Not all the time, but Robin works great in the comics. He works great in, although I never liked the Damian Wayne. I know for a lot of people, the Damian Wayne Robin is like one of their favorites. I never got into the Damian Wayne Robin at all. Like I just find him annoying. I don't know why. He's certainly a badass, but I just find him annoying. Anyway, so I've always been the type of guy that I've always said, and I think John Schnepp agrees with me. John Schnepp and I are on the same page on this, where it's like Robin, the traditional Robin, as we know him, Robin, does not work in a live action environment. Like, because this Batman that we have wouldn't bring a 12-year-old child into a battle with gangsters and machine guns. Maybe that works in the comics, and it has worked in the comics. Maybe it works in the animated stuff, and it has worked in the animated stuff. But that traditional Robin we know of, 12, 13-year-old little kid, like even 15, 16-year-old kid, would Batman bring that into a big battle? And I mean, I've always just had a different, like the live action medium is a different medium than animated or comic books. Now, I've always also thought, though, that if you changed Robin and you adapted Robin for the big screen, where you have a 21-year-old dude that Bruce Wayne discovers and thinks he sees a lot of himself in him and he trains him, and they just happen to call him Robin or call him Nightwing. That can work. That can absolutely work. You just have to understand that it's not going to be the traditional Robin that we've always had. But I've also always had a lot of people, you've probably heard me talk about this before. I've had a lot of people say to me, well, John, how come you don't like the idea of a 16-year-old Robin, but you're perfectly fine with a 16-year-old Spider-Man, huh? Well, one is a teenager with a stick. One is a superhuman metahuman with powers of the gods. One is a kid who can do a backflip. One is a kid who can lift a bus over his head. One can run the 100-yard dash in 13 seconds. One has superhuman speed, strength, agility, and some magical power, undefined spidey senses. One is a human kid. One is basically a god, okay? And if you look up the actual stats, if you look up the official thing in the Marvel thing, like Spider-Man is, he's not just fast and you know, can swing. Spider-Man is superhuman power. He's stronger than Captain America. He's stronger. I mean, he's a force to be reckoned. There's a reason in Civil War that he's like, not the movie Civil War, but the comic run Civil War, that he's one of the prize pieces in the fight between Iron Man and Captain America trying to get Spider-Man. He's a big deal. So don't try to compare Robin to Spider-Man in this type of situation. Because yes, if I'm Tony Stark, and I see a kid who, granted, is 16 years old, but this kid can tear down a building if he wanted to. This kid can pick up a city bus and throw it across the street if he wanted to. That's different from a Batman seeing a regular human, non-superpowered teenage kid who's really good with a stick. I mean, it's a different scenario. And again, I'm not talking about how good they work in the comics. I'm talking about specifically how well they work or don't work or would work in the live action thing. But look, just because I can't think of a way that it would work doesn't mean that there isn't some filmmaker out there who can't think of a way that it'll work. And it also doesn't mean, like I said before, that we couldn't get an adaptation of Robin, a version of Robin that's not what we've traditionally known, but rather one that would work for the big screen. I am all for that. I am all for that. So we'll see what they come up with. All right, the next question comes from Efren Guzman. And Efren Guzman writes, how do you keep up with so many shows and films and able to give your views on it? Do you ever watch a film just to watch a film and not analyze it? Yeah, I mean, I like over the vacation, Ann and I watched Moana like two or three more times. You know, just sat down in the office the other night to watch Doctor Strange again. Look, movies are my life. I love movies. Even if I wasn't doing this particular job, I would watch 5 to 10 movies a week. That's just what I would do because I love movies. A lot of you are the same way. That's just what I do. But, you know, it is also, I'm lucky in that it's also part of my job. So I get to use a lot of hours out of my week watching movies and things like that. I don't actually watch a whole ton of television. I would love to make more time to watch more television. But I just haven't had the chance to do that, really. There's only a few shows that I watch. This year I want to try to start watching more TV because I want to start maybe getting more into some television stuff. But, you know, I'm lucky that I get to do it. It's my favorite hobby when I'm not working, and it's a part of my job when I am. So I'm lucky that way. Kyle White writes, it might still be too early to think about this, but how do you think Disney should go about using Leia in episode 9? Yeah, you know, I talked about this last weekend, and I said, you know, there's still a lot of speculation that maybe that, remember, they're finished shooting episode 8, and they haven't started shooting episode 9 yet. And I speculated last week, and I said, you know, there's a lot of speculation that Princess Leia may be the next major character to die off in episode 8. And so if they did have Princess Leia die off in episode 8, then that renders the whole conversation moot. Then it doesn't matter. It doesn't change anything for episode 9. However, if you watched Movie Talk yesterday, you know that, nope, it sounds like Disney had plans for Leia in episode 9. So clearly she doesn't die in episode 8. So they have plans for Leia in episode 9. Carrie Fisher has now passed away. What do they do? It's a great question. Now, I mentioned this last week too. The advantage that Lucasfilm and Disney have over, say, Universal and Justin Lin when Paul Walker died is that for Fast and the Furious 7, Paul Walker died when they were like halfway, three quarters of the way through shooting the film. And that caused obviously a lot of problems. The quote unquote advantage that Disney has is that they haven't started shooting episode 9 yet. So what should they do? Should they do a CG Princess Leia? I don't want them to do that. Not because I think it's disrespectful, not at all, but just because I don't think it'll work to do a CG Leia. It's an interesting question. I mean, some people will have some odd ideas about, no, you can't use Princess Leia at all because it's disrespectful to Carrie Fisher. I reject that logic. I rejected it with Paul Walker. I reject it now. That logic to me is flawed. You think Carrie Fisher, who, you know, poured a lot of her life, especially the last couple of years of her life, into the Star Wars universe and into Princess Leia, you think she would want Princess Leia now just gone because she's gone? She poured so much of her life, especially the last couple of years with The Force Awakens, with her getting herself healthy again and bringing this character back to the screen and all that kind of stuff. If you think Carrie Fisher would want Leia to be gone, I think you're nuts. I think that's disrespectful. But that doesn't mean that Disney and Lucasfilm has to use the character. Remember, Mon Mothma is a major important character in the Star Wars universe. A major important character in the Star Wars universe. But she was only in one of the movies. Notwithstanding, of course, Rogue One. But she was only in one of the movies. So you can have a super important character not be on screen. You can do that. I'm not saying that's the way to do it. I'm just saying that there are options. That, you know, fortunately, they haven't started shooting the movie yet, so they can reassess what they want to do. You can still have Princess Leia as a presence in the film. Remember, the Emperor was a presence in Star Wars, although you never saw him. The Emperor is definitely a presence in Rogue One, although you never see him. Mon Mothma was the head of the rebellion, but you only saw her in one film, notwithstanding the recent films. So I think that you can still have Princess Leia and not see her. You can just keep the focus of the action elsewhere. Look, obviously, if they had major plans for Princess Leia in episode 9, they're going to have to reassess how they're going to do things. I just think they have a lot of options open to them, and it's not an either-or situation. I think there's 100 different options. And what is the best one? That's something that smarter people than me, which is almost everybody, that's something that smarter people other than me are going to have to decide. But I'm sure we'll speculate about a lot more in the days moving forward. Thanks a lot for the question. Michael K. writes, do you think Tony Gilroy will be involved in more Star Wars films moving forward? I liked what he contributed to Rogue One. Probably. I mean, for those of you who don't know, Tony Gilroy, who is a filmmaker, he was brought in to help out with some of the reshoots and grafting of the stuff. I think he did a very good job. He and, according to Tony, he and Gareth Edwards worked very closely together for that. I think he did a great job. And I think he's a guy that Kathleen Kennedy trusts. So I wouldn't be surprised if we hear that Tony Gilroy gets involved in more Star Wars movies moving forward. Josh Howard writes, God forbid that Ben Affleck drops out from directing Batman. Do you think George Miller would be a suitable replacement? It all depends on... Look, the thing is this. Ben Affleck is not just the director of the new Batman movie. He is the star of the new Batman movie. He is also the writer of the new Batman movie. Which makes me very confused about some of his comments about, hey, if the script's not where I want it to be, I'm not going to do the film. So it's Ben Affleck, the director, saying, if that writer, Ben Affleck, doesn't get his act together and get me a good script, I'm not going to make this movie. Well, you are Ben Affleck. You are the writer. So what's the problem? Anyway, so look, nobody's saying Ben Affleck is going to drop out of the film. All right. But if, and we're just dealing in hypotheticals here. Let's say Ben Affleck were to drop out of the Batman film. That causes a lot of problems because, number one, I think it would probably mean that he's also no longer writing the film, so you got to get a new writer involved. And if Ben Affleck were, if the relationship between Ben Affleck and WB got so bad, and I think they have a very good relationship, by the way. We're just talking hypothetically here. Were he to drop out, both as the director and the writer, I think that would signify some damage between the relationship of WB and Ben Affleck. I don't think Ben Affleck would be our Batman anymore either. I think if we lost him as the director, we would also lose him as the writer, and we would also lose him as the star. And that creates a lot of problems. That one thing starts a domino effect that could lead to disaster. But in the general question, could George Miller be a suitable replacement? Sure, because George Miller is a great director. But I think any one of 100 great directors could also step in. But George Miller would certainly be a name that if, as you mentioned, heaven forbid, Ben Affleck were to drop out of directing Batman, if they then came out and said, George Miller is directing, I won't like it as much as Ben Affleck directing, but I'll go, okay, then this could still work because we trust George Miller, especially after what he just did with Mad Max. So it would be acceptable. It would be acceptable, but it wouldn't be as good if, because Ben Affleck is made to direct Batman, man. So I'd be really bummed out if he didn't. Okay, Brian McDonald writes, other than Star Wars, what movie do you think would cause the biggest public backlash if they announced a remake like Ghostbusters did? Probably Godfather. I think, and remember, I'm like, hey man, reboot anything. I'm even okay rebooting Star Wars. Go ahead, reboot Star Wars. I will never understand people who get upset at reboots. I'll never understand it. Never. Because guess what? Some people liked the new Ghostbusters movie and a bunch of people didn't. But if I'm one of the people who hated the new Ghostbusters, guess what? I still have the original. Like some people act, I've talked about this before, but some people act as if they do a remake, that Blu-ray of the original on my shelf will disappear into the ether. No, it's still there. You still have it. You know, and if it ends up, if they make a good reboot, then great. Now you've got another good movie to enjoy. So I've never understood. So yes, I'd be perfectly fine if they rebooted Star Wars. I mean, other than the fact that they have an ongoing story now, so now is not the time to reboot. But if they ever ended the current storyline and they wanted to reboot Star Wars, I'm fine with it. Because if they make a good movie, yay, I have another good movie to love. And if they make a bad movie, yay, I still have the original Star Wars trilogy. No damage done. But if which one would cause the most backlash? I think other than Star Wars, I think probably The Godfather. I think you'd hear a lot of people getting upset if they try to reboot The Godfather. All right. Sebastian P. Sarlos writes, Creed 2, any updates on when it's going to happen? Well, if I'm not mistaken here, let me look this up. Because I'm pretty sure Creed 2, I think they have a tentative release date too. No release date yet. But it is happening. They've gotten everybody, they've already said that Sylvester Stallone is coming back. We think even Carl Weathers, there were reports that Carl Weathers may be coming in to do like either a flashback or some kind of dream sequence conversation with Rocky. We know Sly Stallone's coming back. And it's moving ahead. They haven't started shooting it yet, but as far as I know, everything's on track for them to absolutely do this movie. All right, where are we? Dylan Steiner writes, when do you think good parody movies will make a comeback? Dude, great question. I used to love good parody movies. Like Hot Shots and Hot Shots Part 2, I think were great. And damn it, what was the name of the one? I love it and I'm forgetting the name of the one with Latrine and Val Kilmer. It's killing me that I'm not remembering right off the top of my head. Top Secret. How could I forget Top Secret? I think Top Secret might be the West. The Naked Gun movies, all that kind of stuff. Then there came about 6 or 7 years ago, maybe 8 years ago, where this whole slew of spoof movies came out, like a whole ton of them, like Meet the Spartans and other things like that. And they were all, in my opinion, just in my opinion, they were all garbage. Just terrible, all lowest common denominator trash. I would love to see a great, like an Airplane, I would love to see a great spoof movie come out again. I thought the first Scary Movie was okay. I'll be a fan. I wasn't a big fan of the rest of them though. I thought they became more and more like Meet the Spartans as they progressed. Then they did one recently, a 50 Shades of Grey spoof, and I can't remember the name of it, but it just came out like a year or so ago, and it was terrible. I had hopes for it, but it was terrible too. So yeah, you and me both, man. When could they come back? I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know if any studio's really ready to invest like $40, $50 million in making and marketing a film like that right now. It might be a while, unfortunately, but man, I'll be happy when a good one comes out again. Okay. Raul Andres Hernandez writes, chances that The Edge of 17 gets nominated for any major Oscars, why or why not? I think there is a chance. I don't think it's going to get nominated for Best Director. I think there is a chance that Hailee Steinfeld could get nominated for the movie. Let me just bring up something here. But I do believe it has a shot for Best Picture. I think Edge of 17, now, it does not have a shot at winning Best Picture, not at all. But in an era where 7, 8, or 9 movies get nominated, I think Edge of 17 has a shot. I think when I put out my top 10 list of my top 10 best movies of 2016, I believe I had Edge of 17 at like number 8 or number 7. Well, 7, 8, or 9. I can't remember off the top of my head. But I had it either at 7, 8, or 9. So I do believe Edge of 17 has a shot, a legit shot, at getting a Best Picture nomination. I love that movie, man. That movie just surprised the hell out of me. It is a classic 80s teenage coming-of-age movie, perfectly transplanted into the modern context. Woody Harrelson's great in it. If you haven't seen Edge of 17, it's poignant, yet it's also very funny at the same time and very heartfelt. You attach yourself to these characters. I thought they did a great job with the movie. So I think Steinfeld has a chance. Unfortunately, I don't think Woody Harrelson has a chance, even though I kind of think he stole the movie. But I think the best chance is Best Picture. Well, again, not going to win. No chance in hell it wins. But I think it has a good chance of getting nominated. All right. Next question comes from Kevin Nevick Murphy, who writes, are you going to any of the AfterCon parties in Orlando for Celebration Friday and Saturday night? Well, look, it looks like me and a whole bunch of the Collider crew are going to go to Orlando, Florida for Star Wars Celebration in April. We haven't booked our flights. We haven't booked our hotel rooms. We haven't 100% confirmed we're doing it, but we most likely are. When we go to cons, we have been known to enjoy our parties. So I think it's if we're there, and it's a pretty good chance that we're going to be there, because I got a rematch looming with Sam Witwer and Freddie Prinze for a Star Wars battle with me and Kenny. But if we're there, you will probably find us at almost all the after parties. Phil Mabut writes, could you do a behind the scenes / Day at Collider video? It would be great to see the process from the morning until you finish and see how the shows come together. You know, it's funny. Dennis and I, we talked like 2 years ago about producing a video like that. And we keep saying, yeah, we're going to do it. Yeah, we're going to do it. Yeah, we're going to do it. And we're always so busy. We just never getting around to doing it. This year, we will do one. We will maybe get Cody or RB3 or somebody else to, or Adam maybe, to document a day in the life of Collider. So you can see what goes on around here all day, every day, and see how everything kind of comes together from, you know, the initial concepts, the writing, the development, pre-production, production, and then delivery, and how everything kind of happens around here. We will do it. We will do it this year. I've been saying that for the last 2 years, but this year we will do it. Thanks a lot for the question. All right. Dylan Christopher Kimmel writes, after that awesome scene in Rogue One, do you think a Vader movie could work? Or do you think Vader works best not as a main character? You got a couple of things working against you for a Vader movie. Number one, like even in the original Star Wars, I think Vader had like 10 minutes of screen time. I think Vader does work in doses because he's so, I'm not talking as in the Force power. I mean, as a screen presence, he's so powerful that he's in doses. I also think it's very, very difficult to tell a story about the bad guy. Every movie that says to be a movie about the bad guy is really a bad guy who's a good guy deep down. And we know Vader in Return of the Jedi comes back to being a good guy, but until that point, he is as rotten and evil and vile and genocidal and murderous as ever. So it's really tough to tell a story from that point. So no, I don't think we will ever get a Vader standalone movie. And it could be wrong. Like if Hollywood smells a dollar and they think fans would be interested, they could do it. I don't think they will, though. And B, I don't think they should, because I think they use Vader perfectly. And I think they should continue. I honestly, I don't think we're going to see Vader on the big screen again. That's where I'm at right now. I actually don't think we're going to see Vader again. But who knows? Hopefully, I'm incorrect about that. Okay. Next question comes from Chase Nori, who writes, how do you feel about the rumor of a Han Solo movie being pushed back to December of 2018? Well, we actually just talked about this on Jedi Council earlier this week. I think they should leave it in May. I want to see Star Wars movies plant their flag in May. But I'm also totally fine if they move it to December. I mean, it looks like they're kind of positioning themselves that December is Star Wars movie season. That's what they're kind of positioning themselves for. And I get it, but I kind of feel like they should, you know, have the anthology movies in May and have the episodic movies in December. I think that would work out better, but I'm totally fine with it. I don't have any major gripes. Look, I don't feel nearly as strongly about it as I feel that these anthology movies should have an opening crawl. It's stupid not to have an opening crawl. It's just stupid. And I know, now I'm going to, a little bit of spoiler here for Rogue One. If you haven't seen Rogue One, which by now, if you haven't seen it, then you're probably not interested in seeing it. But I'm going to give a little bit of a spoiler in Rogue One here, okay? So just fast forward about 40 seconds. I said this on Jedi Council. I will say it again. The big excuse they've been making about not having a opening crawl in Rogue One, it's like, oh, because we want to make it feel different than the episodic movies. Really? Really? You really want to make it feel different? Okay, so is that why you put a digital Princess Leia in Rogue One? So it won't feel like one of the episodic movies? Is that why you put a digital Grand Moff Tarkin so it won't feel like the original, you know, episodic movies? Is that why you put a CG or old footage of Red Leader and Gold Leader? Is that why you have the Death Star? Is that why you have the Carillion Corvette? Is that why you have Darth Vader? Because you don't want it to feel like one of the episode movies. Don't give me that BS. It's bull, all right? Rogue One still ended up being in my top five favorite movies of the year. It's number four on my list of my favorite movies of the year. And I love it. It's great. And as I suspected, I hated the fact that the opening crawl wasn't there, but it didn't take away from the overall movie enjoyment for me. But it was still a mistake. It's a mistake not to have the opening crawl. The opening crawl is Star Wars. Put that back in. Use an opening crawl for the Han Solo movie. Please come to your senses and do that. Stavros... Stavros C writes, how do you guys make a living? The YouTube revenue is not enough as it only pays around $150 per 100,000 views. Does Complex pay you? And if it does, what does Collider offer to Complex? Love this channel. Okay, I'm going to get a little bit of behind the scenes stuff here. Yeah, no, YouTube does not nearly generate enough money to keep an operation like this going. YouTube does not generate enough money at all. Even my buddies, the Fine Brothers, you know, who have like 10 million YouTube subscribers and millions upon millions upon millions upon millions of views, you know, like 100 million views or more every month and all that kind of stuff. Like a little behind the scenes stuff. Like even they struggle like how to keep the lights on because YouTube does not generate enough money. It doesn't. It's becoming a problem. So what we do is we are owned by Complex Media. They own us. And yeah, they pay all the bills. Complex pays all the bills. And one of the ways we actually do generate money is by doing shows for other networks that aren't YouTube. Like the reason we did Film HQ was because Film HQ made a lot of money for us. It made money that we could finance all the stuff that we do on YouTube. We are doing Awesometacular, but Awesometacular is not on YouTube. It's on Verizon Go 90. And when we create shows for other networks, that generates a lot more money than all the shows that we do on YouTube. And so we do these shows on YouTube because we generate a great fan base, you guys, and we're able to create great content that we love doing, but it also establishes us as a legit production company that have a following so that other media networks like Verizon and others that are coming, that they then license us to create programs for them that generates all the money that we then use to pay for everything that we do here on YouTube. So it's a little complex. I just oversimplified it by a million times, but that's the general idea. Complex, you know, pays the bills. And what we do is we generate money for Complex by doing shows both on YouTube. We generate some money on YouTube, but also by producing shows that go on other networks. And we make enough money on those shows that it finances everything that we do here. So that's a very simplistic way of putting it, but it gave you a little bit of a behind the curtain look at that there. Let's see. Evan Calderon writes, What are your expectations for Celebration, Star Wars Celebration? More movie news than 2015 Celebration? If so, anything specific? I think, look, everybody knows I love Disney, I love Star Wars, but I was very, very critical of Lucasfilm and Disney for what they did at Star Wars Celebration 2015. I thought they dropped the ball. I was very open about that and honest about it. I thought they dropped the ball. I think, you know, they made promises that they didn't keep. And honestly, I think Celebration 2015 was a waste. And, you know, I was very open about that and I communicated that. However, they also listen. And I think they listened to the criticism of 2015. Look, they're like anything else. Disney's like anything else. They make mistakes and they try to learn from them. I think they realize they dropped the ball with Celebration 2015. And I think they are going to apply those lessons to 2016. I think we're going to get a lot of stuff at Star Wars Celebration. I don't know if we're going to get the first... I don't know if the first trailer for Episode 8 is going to drop before Celebration. But if it does, we will either at Celebration get the first trailer for Star Wars Episode 8, or we will get the next trailer for Star Wars Episode 8. Like, maybe they drop a Star Wars Episode 8 trailer at the beginning of February. I don't know that they are, I'm just guessing. But if they did, I still think come Star Wars Celebration, they will drop a new trailer. I think we're going to get our official announcement of the next anthology movie, whether that's going to be a Boba Fett movie or an Obi-Wan movie. I'm still keeping my fingers crossed. I still think there's a good chance it's going to be an Obi-Wan movie. Or something else entirely. I think they're going to reveal a whole bunch of new games that are coming out. I think they're going to talk about their new TV animated series that's coming out. I actually know a few things, but I can't talk about them. I think there's going to be a lot of great stuff at Star Wars Celebration this year. That's why we're going to go to Star Wars Celebration this year, because we do believe that Disney has learned their lesson from last year. I think they're going to make it a great event. I think they're going to make it all for the fans. And I think it's going to be wonderful. So yeah, let's keep our eyes open. All right. Next question comes from Jason Scoras, who writes, "Hey John, being from Canada, what drew you to be a Patriots fan? And what are some of the other teams you like to watch?" Well, what happened to me, this is how I became a Patriots fan, okay? Way back in the day, and I'm still a Buffalo Bills fan because I grew up in the Hamilton area, which is very close to Buffalo. It's like an hour and a half from Buffalo. So I grew up with my CFL, but then I also watched NFL and I liked the Bills because they were so close to me. And the Bills went to the Super Bowl and they played the New York Giants with head coach Bill Parcells. And the Giants beat the Bills when the Bills missed that infamous last second field goal to lose the game. And the Giants won. And I was like, I hated the Giants because of that, but damn it, I respected them. So anyway, later on, when Bill Parcells eventually ended up as the coach of the Patriots, I respected him so much that I started watching the Patriots. And I became a fan when Bill Parcells was the coach of the Patriots. That's a long time ago. But that's when I became a fan of the Patriots. A lot of people are saying, "Oh, you only became a fan when they started winning Super Bowls." No, I actually became a fan when Bill Parcells went there. So that's the other teams I really like. I love the Seattle Seahawks. I'm a big fan of the Seahawks. So I was very torn a couple of years ago when the Patriots and the Seahawks were playing each other in the Super Bowl. I was very torn, but I was cheering for the Patriots because they're my number one team. Probably my number two team is the Seahawks. Number three team is the Bills. Number four team, I just like football, man. I mean, now that Los Angeles has a team, I guess number four or five or six would probably be the Los Angeles Rams, even though they suck. Yeah, I just like watching football. I love watching football. Thanks for the question. All right, next question comes from Christopher Michael Woodburn. How do you all deal with the disrespectful comments that people write on the internet? And I got your backs. Look, I tell my staff this all the time. If you're going to do what we do, you have to know that there are people out there who are, you know, morons. And they will say moronic things. I'm not talking about people who disagree with you. Disagreement's great. I love disagreement. Disagreement's wonderful. But there are people out there who are just trolls and morons and whatever. And and you got to be able to just whatever. Okay. I mean, you can't let it get to you too much, because otherwise, you know, if you have 1,000 viewers, you're going to get some that's going to drive you nuts. What's going to happen when you have millions of viewers every month? millions and millions and millions of viewers every month. There's going, the law of averages says that means you're going to get a big chunk of trolls that, and it's like, meh, whatever. I mean, you have to roll with it. And, you know, and also when you get to a certain size, you have to expect that people are going to make fun of you too. And that's cool. Look, like, for instance, a couple days ago, some people wrote to me and said, like, Red Letter Media, who's a great channel, Red Letter Media, and they put out a spoof video that was very clearly directed at us. And at first I didn't watch it because, like, well, why would I want to watch something if they're just going to sit there and insult us and make fun of us, blah, blah, blah. But then a couple of the guys came to me and said, John, if you watch it, it's actually really funny. And so we sat down and we watched and I was like, damn, I wish it wasn't, but this is pretty funny. This is pretty funny stuff. And it was really good. Now, is the stuff that they say in that video true? No, none of it's true. I mean, I don't know whether they think it's true or not, or whether they're just having fun, or I don't know. I don't know what their motivation was, but, you know, it's funny. So I'm going to call it as I see it. It was really funny. I even tweeted it out. I said, damn, I mean, this is pretty funny. So go check it out. But, like, look, when you get to a certain size, you have to be able to look, if you can't laugh at yourself a little bit, and if you can't have some fun with it a little bit, and if you get to a certain size and you can't accept that some people are going to take jabs at you once you get to a certain size, I mean, I feel really honored that Red Letter Media thinks we're important enough to do a spoof on. Okay, whatever. I mean, but if you can't laugh at yourself a little bit and take it in stride, then you're not going to last very long in this business. And so there's some great stuff out there and there's some not so great stuff out there. And, you know, we just deal with it, roll off our back, move on, do the next day's show. Because all you can worry about is doing the best you can the way you really think it should be done. And that's all you can do. That's all you can do. And sometimes that means there are going to be people that like you. There's going to be people that don't like you. There's going to be people that like you and agree with you. There's going to be people that like you and disagree with you. And there's going to be people, you know, it's the whole gamut. And you got to be ready for it. And you got to just be willing to accept that that's part of the reality. And it's fine. It's totally fine. All right. Next question comes from Adeniyi Blackbono Lala. What a great name. What are you hoping for to see in the Justice League movie? Look, I just need to see them focus more on better story and better editing. You know, I liked Batman versus Superman, but I didn't like it as much as I should have liked it because they made some fundamental filmmaking problems in that film that I think they need to address and get to the heart of. I don't think the tone, you've heard me say this before, I don't think the tone of Batman versus Superman was the problem with Batman versus Superman. I don't think the tone was the issue or the tone was the problem. I think the tone is perfectly fine. Nobody complained about the tone of The Dark Knight. The problem was other fundamental issues. And when the movie just didn't work, I think a lot of the fans just tried to find something to make the reason. It was the tone. The tone was the problem. No, the tone wasn't the problem. It was more fundamental than that. I think there was bad story choices, bad editing choices, bad structure of the narrative choices. I think those are the things that led to the problem for making BVS such a divisive movie among fans instead of the universally loved film it should have been. And we'll see how it goes. So all I'm looking for is just better story structure. Give us better story structure, and I think they'll go a long way to winning a lot more people over. All right, John Pope writes, how many movies do you, John, see in a week? How do you balance between seeing what is current with what has been out for some time? New movies, I see about 3 new movies a week, and then at home at night, me and Ann, I know this makes us boring, but our favorite thing to do is still just cuddle up on the couch with a pizza, a bowl of popcorn, something to drink, and watching movies together. That's what we like doing at night. So probably we watch about I watch about 3 new movies a week, probably watch about 3 old movies a week. So that's probably what I do. Corey Patrick writes, any other celebrity trivia schmodown matches being talked about? As a matter of fact, yes. The one you already know about a little bit because Christian, unfortunately, has spilled the beans. We're talking about trying to get The Rock and Kevin Hart to come in for a celebrity schmodown. And we've already began talks. I don't know if it's going to happen. You know, it's all up to them on their side. We would love to have them in. But this week, we've also started talks with 2 other groups that I am not going to reveal at this point because I don't know if it's going to happen or not. But we've had a couple of studios contact us and we're talking about a couple of people that I think you would be very excited about, that I am very excited about. But, you know, again, in Hollywood, just getting celebrities on is really, really tough. It's really tough, next to impossible. Like, I laugh sometimes. Like, people say, why haven't you had Zack Snyder on? Like, because, you know, we had the Russo brothers, for example, in studio to talk about Captain America Civil War. And people say, you're not being fair to DC. Why won't you have Zack Snyder on? As if Zack Snyder's pounding on our door asking to be on our show. Like, as if all these big Hollywood celebrities are just lining up at our door waiting to come in for the chance to be on Movie Talk. Like, no, man, we got to work hard and reach out and try to make schedules happen. And trust me, we ask to have all these people on. It's just a matter of who is then available and, you know, who's dedicating X amount of time to doing online promotion as opposed to television promotion and stuff like that. So believe me, we work to get these people. We work to get these things going. It's just it's very, very difficult to do, but we try our best. All right. Next question comes from Nick Podeet, who writes, do you think Power Rangers will be better than what people think now that we've seen all the characters? Look, I mentioned this on Movie Talk the other day. I have from day one said a Power Rangers movie is a bad idea. I think it's a bad idea. But I have to call it like I see it. And I'm going to admit, I think that first trailer, I think was pretty good. I think it was a pretty good trailer. I love the Rita Repulsa stuff I'm seeing. I think Elizabeth Banks being casted in the first place was a marvelous choice. I'm not going to speak for other people, but I do think Power Rangers will probably end up being better than I thought it was going to be. How much better? I don't know. But I'm starting to suspect that Power Rangers is going to be better than I thought it was going to be. But who knows? Maybe it'll suck as much as I thought it was going to suck. Maybe it'll be amazing. We'll just have to wait and see. Thanks for the question. Will J. Rev Brandt writes, will we or could we see a Captain America cameo or mention in Spider-Man Homecoming? Totally possible. I don't think likely. Because, you know, they've already got Iron Man in there with him, so I don't think they will, but it's absolutely possible. I think it's a definite possibility. Sherman Bingham writes, is there any Gremlins news at all? Because I've seen that Lego has put them in a Lego Dimensions game. Do you think there's a chance we'll see them in a future Lego movie? I think the chances that we'll see Gremlins in a future Lego movie at this point is more likely than we'll see Gremlins in their own standalone live action movie. I think it's a far more greater possibility that we'll see them in a Lego movie. So I still don't think it's super likely, but I think it's more likely that we'll see them there. All right. Ian Howard writes, who are some movie reviewers you admire and which would you credit with inspiring you to make this your profession? Well, look, the original Siskel and Ebert were guys I adored. I loved watching them. And, you know, Ebert especially, and I've mentioned this a few times, that Roger Ebert was a critic that honestly, I only agreed with about 50% of the time. Like half the time I totally disagreed with him. But what I value in movie critics is not whether they agree with me or not. What I value in good film critics are people who have a definitive opinion and then are good at expressing and explaining their opinion. It's not important whether I agree with their opinion or not. That's not what I look for in film reviewers that I like to watch or listen to or read. I just love reviewers who are skilled and talented at formulating a thought and opinion and then are gifted at expressing that thought and opinion in a way that I can walk away going, okay, I know what he thinks and I know why he thinks it. Whether I agree with what he thinks is irrelevant to me. And thus, Ebert, who is a guy I only agreed with half the time, was my all-time favorite dude. He had such a gift for expressing his thoughts and communicating why he thought the way he thought. He was so good at it. But really, the guys who inspired me to start like AMC Movie Talk and what we have now in Collider Video were our sports radio guys. When I started AMC Movie News, which then became Collider Video, it is still my guiding star, my North Star, to make the ESPN of movie news. Because when me and my friends used to talk about movies, we didn't talk about them like the, and there's nothing wrong with them, we didn't talk about them the way the artistic film critics would. We talked about them like sports fans. And I thought, I thought there are people like me out there who are film fans that want to talk about films like this. And that's what we set out to create. So I would say Roger Ebert, I would say Bill McCowan or Bob McCowan of this big Canadian sports radio network, the Fan 590, was a big influence on me. A lot of the ESPN stuff, the PTI guys were a big inspiration. So yeah, there are a lot of different inspirations behind doing what I do. Justin Willard writes, what kind of car do you drive? A staff vehicle? No, actually right now, my last car was a car I really, really liked. It was a Hyundai Veloster. And I enjoyed that car a lot, but my father-in-law, who passed away a few months ago, he had this great like 1999 or 2000, year 2000 Acura Integra that was still in operating condition. And I took the car and I got it fixed up, and that's the car I drive right now. And I'm very happy with it. I'm one of these guys, I don't care about the car I drive as long as it's reliable and it gets me from A to B. That's all I care about. The next new car I buy will probably be an electric. I think I'd like to try an electric car just for the fun of it. Let's see, where are we next? Isle Shaklar writes, do you think La La Land has an advantage in Oscars because Hollywood likes to honor their own? Every Hollywood movie is made by their own. So I'm not quite sure I understand the question. Hollywood likes to honor their own. Guess what? Every movie that's going to be nominated for Best Picture was made by a Hollywood producer. So I don't really understand the question. Stephen Thayer writes, I'm going to try to rip through a couple more here because I'm almost out of time. Stephen Thayer writes, what are Hacksaw Ridge's chances for being nominated for the Oscars this year? I think Hacksaw Ridge has a 65% chance of being nominated for Best Picture. However, I think there are a lot of people who still have a gripe with Mel Gibson. Right or wrong, I mean, a lot of people have their reasons. I can understand their reasons. I don't think you're going to see Mel Gibson get nominated for Best Director. I think had Mel Gibson not made such an ass of himself earlier in his life, I think he would be a lock for a Best Director nomination. Because what he did with Hacksaw Ridge, I think, is amazing. Hacksaw Ridge is actually my number one film of the year. I think Hacksaw Ridge was the best film of the year. I love that movie. And what Gibson was able to accomplish in that movie is remarkable. But he made a complete ass out of himself earlier in the year. So I think there are some people who are still going to hold that against him for a little while. And so I don't think we're going to see him get nominated for Best Director. Hank Dunn writes, do you think if it does get made, there's a possibility of a fellow DC superhero popping up in the solo Batman film? If so, who would you like to see it and why? Thanks, John. Bring on the filthy. Because they're doing this big shared cinematic universe thing, I would rather just see Batman in a Batman film, personally. But I do think they'll probably bring in one or two members of the Justice League to at least cameo, whether that's The Flash or Cyborg or Wonder Woman. I do think you're going to see them pop up a little bit. Craig Stratton writes, if you could change one thing about Star Wars canon, what would it be? Get rid of the midichlorians. Oh, and all the prequels. Jordan Harper writes, are you worried about Fast 8? Not at all. I think going into Fast 4 and especially Fast 5, the Fast and Furious franchise, which I used to hate, found their identity. And they've embraced their identity as just a fun, silly, over-the-top, don't take itself seriously kind of films. And once they embrace that identity, they seem to succeed a lot better. And so I'm not worried about Fast 8 at all. Cyan doesn't mean I think it's going to be an Oscar film, but I'm not worried about it. Cyan Hughes writes, is 2017 in movies the best year for fandom ever had? We won't know until we see all the movies. Christopher Michael Woodburn writes, I just want to thank you for all the great content that Collider pushes out each and every day. It's much appreciated. Well, thank you, Christopher. It's our honor to do it, and we appreciate you even more. Ken Fagan writes, what do you think of the Dark Tower film being a sequel to the book series? Will this alienate audiences, or does it all depend on how they do it? I haven't heard that they're doing it as a sequel to the book series. I haven't heard that, so that might be true. And if it is, I just didn't know about it. If they are doing it that way, trust that they'll do it in such a way that a brand new audience member who's never even heard of the series will be able to walk into the theater and completely understand what's going on. I have no doubt about that. Matt Thompson writes, if budget, time, and manpower were no issue, is there any Collider or other projects you want to take on? Expand a particular Collider series or do some really off-the-wall concept? Honestly, if manpower and budget were no issue, we would do today what we're planning on doing a few years, which is develop our own feature films. Joe Ferrer writes, what happens to movie sets, props, and anything else that is built for a movie after it's done production? Well, some of it's just destroyed and thrown away. Or if you go and visit Warner Brothers, you can take the Warner Brothers studio tour. And one of the places they bring you is these massive, like 5 football field size prop storage where they keep props that they can use for anything. So you've got like Oval Office setups. You've got like backyard setups. You got like, it's amazing. So a lot of stuff they'll just destroy. A lot of stuff they'll store and then recycle for other movies. I'm going to take two more. Stephen Blake writes, do you think we could see a Marvel / DC animated movie? I don't think we're ever going to see a Marvel DC live action movie, but an animated one. Look, Marvel and DC have worked together before in the past with crossover comic books. So I don't see why we couldn't see a Marvel DC animated crossover at some point. I think that'd be fine. Scott Inch writes, do you think Star Trek back on TV can help the franchise and gain new viewers like the JJ movies? Honestly, everything I'm hearing about the new Star Trek series is a disaster. The showrunner left before the show ever even began. I'm hearing it's going to be a disaster. I don't know that for a fact. Maybe it'll turn out to be great, but the things I'm hearing so far are not inspiring confidence. Tristan Durant writes, Civil War was great, and I don't think that you'll find too many that'll disagree, but don't you think that the title / marketing for the film should have been just Marvel's Civil War? In my opinion, it was more of a Marvel spinoff / Avengers 2.5 than a Captain America film. Even when I watch all the Captain America films back to back, Civil War just doesn't fit to make it a trilogy to me. I completely disagree, Tristan. And you're not the only one who feels that way. There's a lot of people who kind of felt that way, but I have to completely disagree. I felt it was very distinctly a Captain America movie. The film was always told from his point of view and followed him throughout. And all the action kind of revolved around Captain America as the movie went on. So that's the big one for me. And last question I'll take today. Lucian Vivitali writes, who do you think should score Avatar 2, Zimmer or Giancino? I simply don't care. All right, guys, that'll do it for me for this installment of Mailbag. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'll be back again tomorrow. Again, make sure you subscribe to our Collider Video YouTube channel. And on top of that, make sure you click that little bell. Even if you're already subscribed, YouTube just changed the way they push out shows to subscribers. There's a good chance that even if you subscribe to our channel, you're not getting notified. What you need to do, I told you I would do it multiple times through the show. What you need to do is go to that little bell beside the subscribe button and click that bell. That will make sure you get notified when new content from Collider Video goes up. All right, guys, that'll do it for me. Thanks so much for joining us. I'll be back again tomorrow. Until next time, I'm John Campia. Bye-bye.